guys, it's a great pleasure to have Albrecht Klemm here tonight and for the next three lectures on the topological vertex matrix models and all that.
Okay, thank you very much.
And yeah, let me remind you, today we will not be going out with the two speakers, they come with Owen and Klemm, but we'll do that tomorrow.
Okay. So it's a pleasure to be here, and I believe that Marcel, for instance, has already talked about the topological A model. So today we will talk about, I mean, it's basically two lectures, and in the first lecture today and tomorrow, I hope I will cover the topological vertex. So today we will talk about the topological A model. And about the topological vertex, if we come to it. And maybe so that you don't forget, I mean, what this topological vertex is. So so the topological vertex, I just say it in words, so that it doesn't get lost in much of the technicality. So the topological vertex is a tool from gauge theory string theory correspondence. To solve the open and also the closed topological A model on Torricalabiau. And it will be Calabiau three folds for this lecture. And here, so to say, I mean, you notice maybe from ADS-CFT, there's this gauge theory, string theory correspondence, but here the gauge theory will be a topological theory, so it will be Chern-Simon theory. The string theory will be the topological string theory. So this is a comparison between two topological series, and therefore, unlike, for instance, in ADS-CFT, where this is still a conjecture, many things you can just calculate both sides, and then you can see that they are equal. I start a little bit with string theory on Calabiau, let's say defaults, and so basically, if you do the sigma model approach, then you can think that this is defined by some map from a Riemann surface of genus G. With maybe some holes, if you have open strings, or maybe also some punctures, if you want to put in vertex operators. And then this maps into M, and this M has the following property. So M is scalar, and then there are equivalent properties, and the following equivalent properties hold. So first, I can say C1 of Tm is 0. And you can also say that there exists a metric on M such that the Ricci tensor of this metric is zero, so that in principle can be picked. But there's, it's an existence proof that it exists, or there exists a unique nowhere vanishing D0 form, which we usually denote by omega. And this is in H D0, M. So this is one dimensional. Or another way of saying it, it has the holonomy group of M would be SUD. And yet another way, maybe I put it here, is that there exist two covariant constant spinors. Eta and eta bar. And in fact, if dimension is odd, they have opposite chirality. If it's even, they have the same chirality. But from this follows, so to say, that you get one half of the supersymmetry if you if you compactify string theory on such a Calabi-Yau. So for instance, if you do type 2, then we get n equal 2 in four dimension. Here on M3. And then if you do heterotic string, you get n equal 1 and so on. So that gives me more or less the theory in four dimensions, and that's also the reason why we are interested in this, because the supersymmetric series, in particular n equal 1 theory, is of some phenomenological interest. But then there are also worksheet aspects. And for this, you need more or less only that M is scalar. Even so, some things require that the first chunk does vanishes. I will then say it explicitly. then it follows that the worksheet has n equal 2, comma 2 super conformal field theory. So this is in the sigma model approach, and that means you have, if you make a small table, you have the conformal dimension, and you also have a new one charge Q, and these things have also some names. So then would be a field TZ, which is has conformal dimension 2, and so this is the Q is the U1 charge, and that's the conformal dimension, and that is the energy momentum tensor. And then you have this super partners of the energy momentum tensor, which have the conformal dimension 3/2, and then they have charge U1 charge plus minus 1. There are two of those, and that's where this n equal 2 comes from. And so these are these super partners of the energy momentum tensor. And then you have also a current, and this has a conformal dimension 1 and charge 0, and that is a U1 current. And the 2,2 comes because you have, so to say, two copies. So that would be, and it would be just 2,0, but you have another copy, 2,n, where all this depends on Z bar. So therefore, you have actually two of these, and the symmetry algebra can be reflected by just looking at the poles in the operator expansion of these fields. And I mean, of course, you more or less probably know it. So if you take the energy momentum tensor and the energy momentum tensor at zero, then you have this characteristic pole over z to the 4, and then comes c with some factor, 1/2, and then there will be a derivative of the energy momentum tensor here, which goes with c with c, and then there comes also a term where t comes up, and there comes the conformal dimension of this thing. So this is h of t indeed, and then this goes with c to the 2, and then there are regular terms. And similar, if you take t z of g plus minus, then you have here the conformal dimension, so this corresponds now to this piece. Here you have the conformal dimension of this g, and then g plus minus over this. And then the next one would be a d g plus minus, and it goes with z. And then again, regular terms. And more. This one is has then, of course, here, as you can see already, here comes the conformal dimension, so it's 1, g, z, and something like dz, z, and regular, and then g plus, g minus. So here again you have the central charge is 2 over 3 c over c to the 3, and then you get the U1 current, and you get also the energy momentum tensor and the derivative of the U1 current and regular. So you see that everything on the right-hand side has, of course, the same conformal dimension. On the left-hand side, this determines this power of z. And then finally, we have the fact that this is a current which measures the U1 charge. So if you take g plus minus, you get 1 over z plus minus. This corresponds here to this plus minus. And then gz plus regular. And then GZ is just the U1 algebra. So this gives C over 3Z to the 2 plus regular. Now for the definition of the topological field theory, it's also important to define charges. And the charges are so these are operators, and the charges are defined.
Two T terms. direct to G. So G plus G minus B.
This one?
Yes.
This one? T. This is, sorry. So this should be, let me see. So first of all, this should be Z. So this says, yeah, this would be Z, and this would be also Z. Let me just check. And then this should be C squared. Let me check about this. Z must be, that's okay. Seems okay. Okay, I think that's maybe okay. Thank you. So the, well, I mean, we can also define charges. So these are the operators or field operators. Operator algebra. And then the charges, they are then given by an integral, which is dz over 2 pi I. And now you have to insert a z with the right power. So you take h of A, so if this is the field operator, minus 1, and then A of Z, and if you want to pick out a particular mode, then you get, you put also this N, and then you get an operator, AN. And in particular, important are the operators A0, I mean where N is 0. So the N equal, if N is 0, you have actually a name of for this. So it's usually called Q plus, which is this one with G with H equals 0. And then we have Q minus, which is this one. And then you have Q minus, which is G minus, and then you have Q minus bar, which goes is G. So I mean, these are just more common names for these objects, and now you can see that Q plus squared equal Q bar plus minus squared equal 0. So they are anti-commuting because these are fermionic, that, because they have, I mean, you can also see it, already see it from the fact that they have conformal dimension 3/2. And then you have, out of this U1 currents, you make actually two particular combinations of U1 currents according to the chirality. So you defined an F vector U1 current. So it's a vector U1 current. And then you define an F axial, so an axial U1 current. And it's convenient also, since we are on two dimensions, we have also the Euclidean Minkowski space, which is also an U1. So this is the Euclidean rotation, which is also a U1. And now you can actually work out the algebra. So if you take Q plus minus Q plus minus bar, then you get here the charges which correspond to the energy momentum tensor, which would be the Hamiltonian, the energy and the momentum. And by the way, the other things are zero. So or here, for instance, if you take G plus with G plus, then this has no poles. And similar here, you don't get any commutator. And this now reflects the fact how the G plus plus minus transform with respect to this Euclidean U1. So you get minus plus Q plus minus. And if you take the F and commute it with G plus minus, then you get minus Q plus minus. And if you take the F vector and act it on this one, you get minus plus Q plus minus. And maybe here I can write what it is if you take the axial current with Q plus minus, then you get minus plus Q plus minus. And if you take the axial current with respect to Q bar plus minus, then you get minus plus, and here you get plus minus Q bar plus minus. So this is the algebra of the charges, and you can of course also write down the ones for the higher modes, and you get the Virasoro algebra, and then the explicit mode representation of the superconformal algebra. But we don't need this; we just need this the charges of the zero modes. And now you can. I mean, basically, the idea is now you see that these are operators which are nilpotent, and if that's something that we want, because we want to define the cohomology, we want to define. As physical Hilbert space, some cohomology. Which we call H of Q. I mean, if Q squares to zero, and that would be the Q closed states over the Q exact states. So in other words, if you have a state eta, then it's equivalent to eta plus something which is Q lambda. And well, in order that this is well defined on correlation functions, let's say eta bar, you must have something like that Q of the vacuum is zero. So otherwise it would change correlation functions. So this equivalence relation must be good in correlation functions. And well, I mean, now the problem is that you are on a Riemann surface, and in order that you can define this Hilbert space correctly, this Q must be a scalar. So on non-trivial worksheet, Q has to be a scalar. To define the Hilbert space. And that is obviously not the case, because it transforms under the Lorentz group. But what you can do, and that I think Marcel has certainly mentioned that, so what you can do is you can modify the Euclidean U1 by by the two other U1s and obtain in this way a modified assignment of the space-time transformation properties in which a particular combination of Q becomes a scalar. So, well, I mean, there is now, there are now two twists. There's the A twist, which in which you say this new Euclidean action is actually the old Euclidean action generator plus the vector current, and then there is the B twist in which the Euclidean action, the new one, would be the old plus the axial current. And I don't know, I mean, you can also say this, you can say this if you, I don't know, do you have mentioned this with the relation to the BST quantization of the bosonic string? I mean, that's, so to say, nice if you want to see that the measure in this topological string tree is very similar like the one of the bosonic string. So in, you can identify, yeah, maybe I can mention this very briefly. So, well, I mean, you can also take the twist. I mean, there is a plus and a minus twist. Plus minus twist, and this you define by changing the energy momentum tensor. So the energy momentum tensor would become just the old energy momentum tensor. Maybe I put also a prime. The old energy momentum tensor plus minus the 1/2 of the derivative of this current. And now, if you do that, of course, also the algebra changes, and therefore the transformation of the fields with respect to the Lorentz group changes. But what is maybe interesting, if you now take G plus and J and this modified TZ and G minus, then it's exactly like if you quantize the bosonic string with ghosts. So essentially, this is then becomes the ghost current, this J, and this becomes the BST current, and this becomes the energy momentum tensor now of matter and ghost, and that last one becomes the B ghost. So this is like, so it's like in the quantization. Quantization of bosonic string, and as a as an, so to say, a spin-off of this, if you want, for instance, to, I mean, if you do the gauge fixing, then this gauge fixing in this B model or in this topological twisted models is actually quite analogous to the gauge fixing in the ordinary bosonic string. So, for instance, the measure over the modulized space of maps and so on is similarly constructed. Yes?
Why did you put a
hat
on the J
plus? Or the, in some sense, this is the twisted series, so maybe I should put everywhere these primes. I mean, even so, I don't modify the primes, but they have other charges, if you like. I mean, the G's I don't modify, so let's put, thank you. So this is then the standard bosonic ghost, and this is the BST current, which is, of course, something like BC, and this is the ghost current. Sorry, this is the ghost current. This measures the ghost charge. Good. And so if you want to summarize that what I have said, then it's maybe good to make this small table. So the A-twists, the A-twist is actually here the plus minus twist. You see, I have defined a twist on this chiral halves. So the A twist would be the plus minus twist, and the B twist would be the plus plus twist. And now, if I summarize what I have said in this in a table, then I can do this as follows. So we have the U1 Euclidean before the twist, and then we have the A twist and the B twist, and we can sort of put our various Qs, our four Qs, minus, plus, minus, plus, and then the U1 charge you can see from the commutator with ME. And now, of course, it would be nice if I had it on the blackboard, because then I can find errors. But let's keep the fingers crossed, or you check it in your writing. And then the U1 vector and the U1 axial were like this. So we have one minus one minus one. So this is Q. And then here we have minus one, 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 minus one. And if you also want to list the spin, then they are all, this one are on the in the one half of the canonical bundle. So this is the spinor bundle on the Riemann surface, and so is this. And this is in the bar of it. And then in the A twist, you have now the U1 Euclidean, the new one. And then you have, so to say, the spin with respect to this new spin connection. And and here it becomes 0, 0. And here it becomes minus 2, minus 2. And then the spin here is a scalar as we want it, and it is then k and k bar. I hope that's correct. Okay. And here we have 2, 0, 0, and here we have this was before 2, and here we have then 1, 1, 1, 1, and k. And k bar. I think. So then, in other words, now these ones are good for the A twist, this combination. And for the B twist, it would be this combination, which is good. And so we get these two BST operators. By QA and QB. So QA would be just the ones which are good here. So it would be Q minus plus Q bar plus. And then QB would be Q plus bar plus Q minus bar. And now you can, well, let me just make in remarks what seems important to me about this construction. So one thing is the U1A has actually a quantum anomaly. And if you write it down, so if you write what d mu A, which should be zero, is, you find that, so if you integrate this over the worksheet, you find that this one is actually C1 of the pullback of the tangent bundle, of the holomorphic tangent bundle. And you see that now you need actually that C1 is zero, because this is zero if C1 of Tm is zero. And here you need the Calabi-Yau condition. So for the B model, because we twisted with the axial U1, you need the B twists, while for the A model, it's actually you need the vector twist, which is not anomalous in any case. So A models can be defined on Kähler manifolds, but B models can only defined on Calabi-Yau manifolds. So here we need, so B model needs the Calabi-Yau condition. So that is the one, and now in principle there should be a long discussion, but I don't think we have time. So so now if you work out really how the operators act, then you see that the cohomology that you get from the from QA is equivalent to the Dirac cohomology on this target space M. And if you look, so this was the second remark, it's about the Hilbert space. it's in particular finite. And then if you look at QB, then it is actually H P comma Q M Q T M. So it's this Dolbeau cohomology groups, and so that's that. And now I should maybe just tell you what the topological A model. So about the B model, we will not talk too much. So I just talk about the topological A model. Now on top, more specifically. So what is the interest in this topological A model? In the topological A model, I mean, of course, we know that if you have string theory, then you have a path integral which is varied over the word sheet metric, and then it's varied over this map X. So this would be sigma GH into M. And then there's a functional variation about over all the fermions. Remember that we have this n equal 2 on the world sheet, and then it's weighted against an action which depends on H X, and that are the quantities which are various, and of course the fermions. But it also depends on what we call background parameters. So this is the metric and the B field. So these are background parameters. They are not varied over. Well, that's, so to say, a shortcoming of first quantized string theory. They are fixed. And you also know that if you are in the critical dimension, then this variation over H actually becomes a sum, which is quite good. So only over the conformal classes you have to vary. So you get here a sum over M, and then an integral over some measure on the modulized space of genus G surfaces. Well, let me write this like this, so that the measure gets if you make such an expansion, then also the dilaton becomes important. So there's the string coupling constant, is basically e to the minus phi. And let me call this lambda. And so you get something like lambda to the 2 g minus 2. So this is the dilaton. And that is also serves as the, so if there you have this vacuum expectation value, it's the is the string coupling. And so you are left with this integral now over I mean, now you get something like the measure. So this measure is now this more complicated variation, the fermion. And then here you only, this only depends, now this S depends. Just call this S depends on X, fermion, and G and B. And now in the topological, so this somehow becomes a measure. Now in the topological A model, we have the following simplification. So S can be written as a two-dimensional, so this is the S of the topological A model, can be written as a two-dimensional integral over something which is BIST exact. I don't want to specify it. And then something which is just the pullback of the Kähler class. So there's a parameter T, and then we have here the worksheet, and here we have the pullback of the Kähler class, actually I of, let's call this, plus B. So this is the Kähler class, and this is the B field. And this fact that now this is a is BIST exact is nice, because basically it doesn't play a role in the correlation function on what this depends. So for instance, if this depends on some parameter and you make a derivative with respect to this parameter, then you get this commutator down in your correlation function, but then you can anti-commute it with all observables because they are closed. And it will finally act on the vacuum, but the vacuum, as we assumed, was also invariant, so this variation actually is zero. So in particular, this means that from this complicated metric dependence, which of course on a Calabi-Yau we would never really be able to specify because the metric is generally not known, we only get the scalar parameters here. So these are essentially volumes of certain curves, and this is all that the B model depends on. So now, so this is true in the critical dimension, this first equal sign, because otherwise the symmetries that you have used to eliminate the H are not present. But then if you make the A model reduction, and that is sort of a supersymmetric reduction, I mean, this, for instance, can read in this mirror book or in the report that Marcel has written more explicitly. So what you get then is actually a sum, and the sum is as before over the genus, but then it's also over B in H 2MZ, where, so this is the class in which the curve in which the curve lands. So this is the a class of the image curve. And so the supersymmetric reduction, maybe I should say one word, is basically like a semi-classical expansion which is exact. So if you look at the string, at this measure, then the bosonic piece is actually has a subtle point if you have holomorphic maps. So as a consequence, this reduction is only to the holomorphic maps. And this modelized space, I mean, now you get just a sum of integrals over the modelized space of holomorphic maps. And they can be formally written now like this. So here we have, maybe I should write it. So this would be the modelized space suitably compactified of holomorphic maps. And then there has to be a class, which also depends on G and B, which I have to integrate this over. And then this is only multiplied by Q beta, and this Q beta is essentially the exponential of this guy. So Q beta is something like e to the 2 pi I. Maybe here I have to be more careful with the 2 pi I factors as before. And then B is in a lattice because H is in a lattice, so you can sum over integer lattice vectors. And then there will be a B I, and then you have a basis of curves, which I call C I, and over this you have to integrate. So these are bases of curves here in H2, and over this you have to integrate this E omega plus B. And this usually is called TI, which is, so to say, the complexified volume of the particular curve in the, which is a generator of this lattice, so it's a complexified volume. So if there would be no B, it would be in some sense just the volume, but now it's a complex parameter. So beta is a vector, and now you have a basis of this one, and the degree is given by some integer numbers, which count. In which class this B is? So basically, this is. What do you mean? I see what you say. Of course, I'm stupid. There is a sum over I, but not a sum over beta I. Thank you. Good. So, and then it is actually more convenient, as usual, not to consider the partition function. So that would be, in some sense, the reduction of the string partition function. But often, because then you get only contributions from irreducible maps, it's more convenient to consider the free energy.
Yes? Structure.
Yes?
Has this been developed at this level of precision?
So if you have SU3 structure.
G2.
Oh, G2. Yeah, I mean. Not really, because. It has to be different because you don't have this 2,2 structure on the worksheet. And if you don't have this 2,2 structure on the worksheet, then basically what you can define are certain indices, which for instance the if you for instance have only 2,0 supersymmetry on the worksheet, then you can sort of still twist in this direction, and these things have been tried to compute. But if you have no worksheet supersymmetry, it's not very well developed. So this 2,0, there are things that you can indeed calculate in this half-twisted models, as people call it, and they make sense and have also nice mathematical interpretation. But for the other things, I'm not really sure about this, or maybe you don't. So, I don't think it's actually much known. Yeah. So if you for instance give up Calabi-Yau, that's fine because then you still have this A model twist, but. But already, if you, so to say, do the heterodic string or something, there's only a limited things that you can do. But this 2,0 things are still relatively well developed, I would say. So the so if you consider this free energy, which is just log of C, then you get the same thing, a G beta sum, and then now you get, so to say, a little bit different modulized spaces because they are now connected. So these are connected pieces, which still depend on G and beta, and then you get C, a virtual fundamental class, which depends also on G and beta. And these numbers have been called the Gromov-Witten invariants, so they are generally in Q and are known as Gromov-Witten invariants. And of course they are weighted by this Q beta. So in, and in some sense this topological vertex is essentially to calculate these numbers in a very efficient way, because the way of calculating these numbers is somewhat cumbersome. But before I want to, well, I mean, yes, probably, oh, I'm close to the end, maybe like 10 minutes. Yeah, so let me not go into this detail. We can maybe, if you like, you can ask me privately, but there are also not only this invariance, but there are also Gopa-Kumar-Wafa invariants. And then there are Donaldson-Thomas invariants. And, well, I mean, if you restrict your deep brain charges to D1, D6, D2, and D0, and here also to 1, D6, D2, and D0, then they are all equivalent. So it doesn't matter which you calculate. They are all equivalent. That is what the topological string calculates. But if you want to, for instance, to do more D6 brains or D4 brains, which would be also natural in the A model, then there's more to say, which is not computed by the topological string. So, okay. And then maybe, maybe it's also interesting, let's call them just N G beta, and they are all in Z, which is quite remarkable, and they are usually called NGK, and they're also in Z. This is mathematically not proven, but this is mathematically proven. So, so let me, in preparation of what I want to say for the vertex, come to some idea of localization. I mean, in some sense, we had this supersymmetric localization, which just localized to the subtle points of the action. But then there is a toric localization, and now I want to assume that I am on a toric manifold. So I have we specialize the toric manifolds. And I will say a little bit what they are later. Manifolds. And in particular, I want to consider something which is the canonical bundle over a toric Fano variety. So this is a toric Fano variety. And I just want to give you some ideas how eventually you can calculate this integral. So the question is how to calculate this integral. Ultimately we will do it by the vertex, but there is some aspect of this localization which I need. So it's well known that on these toric varieties, so on toric B, we have C star to the D action. So if this is also the dimension of the space, then we have such an action. So, and then C is just the complex plane without the zero. Now imagine you have an element out of this model I space. So for instance, I take M G zero, and well, there is a certain projection map, so it's better to fix one point. This is one point fixed. Well, it also depends on beta. MG beta, let's say is zero, which means no point fix, and here it means one point fix. But imagine you have such an point in this modulized space. So this modulized space is a complicated thing. But if you take a point and you can evaluate this map, so basically it means that here you have a map and a curve in this modulized space. And now if you evaluate it, then you get by this map, you get a curve in this target space in a certain class beta. So this is what evaluation means. So now this maps to this toric base. And somehow you need some bundle. You must construct a bundle over this modelized space so that maybe the churn class of it can be taken to integrate it over. And one way of getting this is actually quite simple. You take here the canonical bundle over this space, and then you pull it back by this evaluation map to a bundle over this space. And then you can also pull it back once more by pi to a bundle over this, actually like this, over this space. So now you can try to take the churn class of this bundle. Now you have a bundle over this modulized space. Now you can take the churn class, and eventually the churn class will give you a volume form over this modulized space, which you can integrate. And that is actually what happens here. So you get a bundle, which we can call UB. And now we can define the RGB basically so this is without a point, is this as the top churn class of this bundle UB. And that's something which is mathematically well defined in this case, and you can try to evaluate it. And the idea to evaluate it is, I mean, if you have a complicated, so the good thing is you can also pull back the torus action. So for instance, if you move the curve by the torus action, then of course this element in this space will also move, and that and it means in particular MG beta has a torus action on it. So let me just make this remark. So P F also pulls the torus action. Oh no, it's actually just this. The torus action to MG beta. And then if you have this torus action, then you can try to localize on this space with respect to the torus action. And well, I'll give you a more primitive example, but if you have actions on group manifolds, then the fixed points of this action say something about the topology. For instance, if you have a P1 and you can rotate this P1, it has precisely two fixed points, and indeed the Euler number is the number of these fixed points. And so this is a general feature, and it's more complicated in this case, but the idea is the same, that that this integral star is calculated, gets only contributions from the fixed points the fixed points of the induced toric action, of the pullback torus action. And that leads, so to say, to combinatorical methods involving this fixed point locus. So now I have to tell a little bit more about this torus, the toric varieties. So the toric varieties are basically varieties which have a huge amount of symmetries because the torus acts on them. So let's make this toric varieties. And I maybe just defined what it is, and then I stop. So, yes?
What did you see here? You have some contribution from here?
From the fixed point locus. Yeah. So the fixed point locus of, so basically the maps which stay fixed under the torus action, they have an image in this modelized space, and this this locus you have, so to say, to control. And then you can get the Euler number or get this integral, essentially. This is, was done by Koncevich. So toric varieties, so basically one basic feature is, let's say we have M toric, and maybe dimension D, then the D star acts on them. On M T D. That's maybe the most important feature of them. And and so we come to a definition. So we take we take C M and we subtract a certain loci. D1 to DR, so this is basically the loci which is defined by the intersection of certain devices. And then we take this and mod it out by C star R. So this has to be actually R plus D, so that the manifold becomes D-dimensional, because this, of course, is also like a complex number. And the action of C star to the R is given by charge vectors, by charges. I mean, this comes basically because there is a gauge linear sigma model, and for them they are the literally the charges. And so they have two indices, Q alpha, and this alpha runs from 1 to R, and another index I, where the I runs from 1 to R plus D. And they are in Z. And now you can specify the action. So if you take, this has coordinates x1 to x R plus D, then the action would be x I goes to lambda. Now I have to introduce various lambdas, alpha. And then q alpha I x I. And these lambda alphas, they are all themselves. Also, they are in C star for all alpha from 1 to R. So there are R of these things, and basically what you have to give is this charges, and an example would be P2. So in P2 you have a Q, you have only one of these, and it's a 3 vector, which is 1, 1, 1. And then you have divisors, di is equal xi equals 0, so in this case is 3, and then this z is actually given by the intersection of d1, d2, d3. That means you just have to eliminate x1 equals x2 equal x3 has to be subtracted, and and then you have still two C star actions acting on P2, and there's a nice way of depicting it, which I want to explain then maybe tomorrow because I'm running out of time. So you have C star 2 acting, and it's a good idea to make the fixed point to denote the fixed point of this action, and there's one total fixed point, which be xi equals xj equals 0 is a fixed point. And you see these are 3 points, because you can take 1, 2, 1, 3, and 2, 3. And these are these 2 points, these 3 points, so it would be, for instance, x1 equal x2 equals 0. And then you have you have fixed lines, so these are fixed points, let's say. And then you have fixed lines, and that would be just xi equals 0. This is also 3 fixed lines, and this, so to say, are the fixed lines. So this maybe is x1 equals 0, and this x2 equals 0, this is x1 equals 0, and so on. And and from these diagrams, where actually the remaining torus action degenerates, you can, so to say, by giving them, you can specify the toric variety quite nicely. And also here you see what I said maybe before, that the number of fixed points is in this case also the Euler number of the P3. So the Euler number of P3 is of course 3, and that is also the number of the fixed points. And you can imagine maybe now that if I pull back this to this vastly more complicated space, the torus action, then, and I want to calculate something which is a top churn class, like for instance the top churn class of this bundle U beta, then this also leads me to just the counting of fixed points. It's a little bit more complicated. You have to weight these fixed points by certain things, but at the end it's sort of a counting of the fixed points. Okay, so maybe I should stop here, and then tomorrow in the first half hour, I think we come then to really to the vertex.
So what happens with the dimensions of these RGB?
Yeah, so the dimension, so there is, so if you want to have the dimension of this MG beta, it's complicated in principle, but there is, so to say, a naive dimension. This naive dimension comes from an index theory. And this naive dimension would be would be the first churn class integrated over this curve beta. And then it would be one. Maybe I should make it like this. 1 and then 3 minus the dimension of M. Now, in our case, I will not directly do these toric varieties, but I do, as I said before, for instance, the canonical bundle over the toric variety. And then this first term class is still 0. Because, so to say, it's the anti-canonical bundle over it. And then the dimension, indeed, is still 0. If it's not, if it's a Fano variety, then this factor is positive. And so the dimension would be positive. I mean, let me say it like this. So if the dimension is zero, the naive dimension, then this means it's basically like a point counting problem. It's a point counting problem because, I mean, your modelized space is naively at least zero dimensional, so you count points. It can still be... is kind of trivial, but as a matter of fact, this generic situation is not realized for the toric variety. So in the toric variety, this thing is positive, and then you have a C star action. And if you see this diagram that I've drawn, actually it's a modelized space of maps into the toric variety. And not the Calabi-Yau. In order to get the Calabi-Yau, I pull back this bundle. And then first the modelized space is positive, and then I do this localization. And this localization, so to say, is a sophisticated way of counting these points, if you like. So maybe I haven't seen this, did this very clearly, but in the bottom row of this diagram, there was something like BG, but I should set this is a thing on the which maps to the base of this thing. And if it maps from the base, then this is positive, and you get really this torus action. So it's a trick of counting that.